Okay, we'll start.
बे
In addition to our regular Dhamma program, chanting and Dhamma discourse, we'll see something about this end of Raini retreat, the end of Varshavasa Raini retreat. And it is a day of gratitude. It's a gratitude giving day that all over the world they celebrate these days. Gratitude giving day. Why this is called gratitude giving day? Why people celebrate this? That also we will see. And people in the sense, those who know this Buddhist culture, or say why Buddha recommended this gratitude giving day, the end of this Varshavasa rains retreat, those things we will see. And you can take precepts also. You can take Shila, Pancha Shila and Ashta Shila. Some of you, if you are interested today, you can take this. and of course, that's what we were discussing in this Brahmajala Sutta also. The Brahmajala Sutta, we were discussing the morality, the moral aspects. Buddha emphasized morality so much according to one's own ability and truthfulness. And at three levels, the morality was discussed in this Brahmajala Sutta. And that is the core of Buddha's teachings. For that matter, Buddhist philosophy, the core is the morality. Morality in the sense, based on whatever we do, we get back, so we should not do bad things. That kind of understanding, based on that kind of understanding. Anything that inflicts suffering on us, pain on us, misery for us, we should avoid that. That is what is the way of living, right? Nobody wants suffering. So to avoid that kind of suffering, we should not inflict any kind of suffering, any kind of displeasure, any kind of misery on others, because we will get back. It will hit back to us. It is very, very clear. That's what Buddha wanted to highlight. He wanted to teach this universal law through this morality, through these moral precepts. Whatever we do, we get back. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction that works in the existence, that works at our mental level, in our actions, in our speech, that will happen. So be careful. So that's what he wanted to teach. He wanted to teach this law of cause and effect, law of attraction. So he highlighted morality, moral precepts in this Brahmajala Sutta. And then, of course, other wrong views also he highlighted, 62 wrong. That we will see after this chanting, this taking precepts, and maybe for some 5 minutes we practice meditation. And mentally we learn this art of sharing gratitude. That is also important. First, if it won't arise in the mind, that gratitude, that gratefulness, that that intention of gratitude and respect, then you will not perform it in the form of actions or in the speech. First, it has to arise in the mind. So for that, we practice meditation and we see that how we can cleanse our mind, purify our mind, so that those thoughts will arise in the mind, the thoughts of gratitude and respect. Because wise people say, if you are progressing in spirituality or Dhamma or in the mental purification, the basic qualities that arise from the mind are this gratitude and respect. To celebrate that kind of noble qualities, actually this program is designed all over the world. This Kathina Chivaradana program. So with this introduction, we will start this chanting program, and then the chanting which highlights this gratitude and respect, that we will see, and we will chant that one, and then we take up the sutta for some time, just for us. No, before that you can take the precepts. So now itself we can just decide who will take the Panchashila and who will take Ashtashila. Then we will go ahead with this Shila. taking sila, and then meditation, and then discourse. Then you can ask questions also. Just maybe takes more than 1.5 hours, or maybe a little more than that. So that is today's program. And then I thought of conducting Punyanumodana also. Those who have offered with gratitude for this cause, you can just remember your departed relatives, and if there is time, you can tell their names also. If there is no time, you can just remember them, and then I will conduct this Punyanumodana also, just for some 3-4 minutes. Yeah. So that way the program will be complete, because when you gain punya, it should be shared. That is a must actually. Then it will, the punya will become perfect. It will become complete. So that Punyanumodana also we practice. Okay. So that is today's program. So now we will start with one small chanting. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा इति पिसो भगवारहं सम्मा संबुद्धो विद्याचरण संपन्नो सुगतो लोकविदु अनुत्तरो पुरी सदम्मसारति सत्ता देवमनुसानां बुद्धो भगवाति नमो तस्सा सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा ये च बुद्धा अतीता च ये च बुद्धा अनागता पच्युपन्ना च ये बुद्धा अहं वंदामि सर्वदा नत्ति मे शरणं अन्यं बुद्धो मे शरणं वर एतेन सच्चवज्जेन होतु मे जयमंगलं उत्तमंगेन वंदेहं पादपंसो वरोत्तमं बुद्धेयो कलितो दोषो बुद्धो कमतुतं मम बुद्धं याव निब्बान पर्यन्तं शरणं गच्छामि स्वाकातो भगवता धम्मो संदिटीको अकालिको एहि पश्चिको उपनायको पच्चत्तं वेदितव्यो विन्नोहीति नमो तस्स नियानिकस्स धम्मस्स ये च धम्मा अतीता च ये च धम्मा अनागता पच्युपन्ना च ये धम्मा अहं वन्दामि सर्वदा नत्ति मे शरणं अन्यं धम्मो मे शरणं वरं एतेन सच्च वज्जेन होतु मे जयमंगलम् उत्तमंगेन वंदेहं धम्मं चति विदुत्तमं धम्मेयो कलितो दोषो धम्मो कमतुतं मम धम्मं याव निब्बान पर्यन्तं शरणं गच्छामि सुपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संगो उजुपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संगो न्यायपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संगो सामीचिपटिपन्नो भगवतो सावक संगो यदिदं चत्तारि पुरिस युगानि अट्ट पुरिस पुग्गल एषा भगवतो सावक संगो आहुनेयो पाहुनेयो दक्किनेयो अंजलि करणीयो अनुत्तरं पुण्यकेतं लोकसाति नमो तस्स अट्ट अरिय पुग्गल महासंगस ये च संगा अतीता च ये च संगा अनागता पच्युपन्ना च ये संगा अहं वंदामि सर्वदा नत्ति मे शरणं अन्यं संघो मे शरणं वरं एतेन सच्च वज्जेन होतु मे जयमंगलम् उत्तमंगेन वंदेहं संगं चति विदुत्तमं संगेयो कलितो दोषो संगो कमतुतं मम संगं याव निब्बान पर्यन्तं शरणं गच्छामि विपत्ति पटिवाहाय सब्ब संपत्ति सिद्धिय सब दुःखं विनाशाय सब भयं विनाशाय सब रोगं विनाशाय भवेदीर्घायुकदायक सब लोकं हितत्ताय परितं तं वनामहे समन्ता चक्रवालेषु यत्रा गच्छन्तु देवता तद्धम्मं मुनिराजस्स सुनन्तु सर्गमोक्तं धम्मश्रवणकालो अयं वदन्तः धम्मश्रवणकालो अयं वदन्तः परितश्रवणकालो अयं वदन्तः नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स उदेतयं चक्कुमएकराजा हरिस्सवन्नं पटविप्पबासो तं तं नमस्सामि हरिस्सवन्नं पटविप्पबासं तयज्जगुत्ता विहरे मुरत्तिं विहरे मुदीवसं ये ब्राह्मणा वेदगुसब्बधं मे ते मे नमो ते चमं पालयन्तु नमत्तु बुद्धानां नमत्तु बोधिया नमो विमुत्तानां नमो विमुत्तिया एवं सो परितं कत्वा मोरो चरति एसन अपेतयं चक्कुमेक राजा हरिस्सवन्नं पटविप्पबासो तं तं नमस्सामि हरिस्सवन्नं पटविप्पबासं तयज्ज गुत्ता विहरे मुरत्तिं ए ब्राह्मणा वेद गुसब्बधम्मे ते मे नमो ते चमं पालयन्तु नमत्तु बुद्धानां नमत्तु बोधिया नमो विमुत्तानां नमो विमुत्तिया एवं सो परितं कत्वा मोरो वसमकप्पयीति एतेन सच्चवज्जेन सोति नो होतु सब्बदा एतेन सच्चवज्जेन होतु नो जयमङ्गलम् एतेन सच्चवज्जेन पातु नो रतनत्तयम् नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स वंदे तनंकरं बुद्धं वंदे मेदंकरं मुनिं शरणंकरं मुनिं वंदे दीपंकरं जिनानमे वंदे कोंडान्यसत्तारं वंदे मंगलनायकं वंदे सुमान संबुद्धं वंदे रेवतनायका वंदे शोभित संबुद्धं अनमदसिं मुनिन्नमे वंदे पदुम संबुद्धं वंदे नारदनायकं पदुमुत्तरं मुनि वंदे वंदे सुमेधनायका वंदे सुजात संबुद्धं पियदसिं मुनिन्नमे अत्तदसिं मुनिं वंदे दम्मदसिं जिनान्नमे वंदे सिद्धार्थ सत्तारं वंदे तिस्सा महामुनि वंदे पुस्सा महावीरं वंदे विपस्सिनायकं सिकिं महामुनि वंदे वंदे वस्सभुनायक ककुसंदं मुनि वंदे वंदे कोनगमनायक कस्सपं सुगतं वंदे वंदे गौतमनायक अत्तवीसति इमे बुद्धा निब्बानमतदायक नमामि शिरसा निच्चं ते मं रक्खन्तु सब्बदा एतेन सच्चवज्जेन सोतिनो होतु सब्बदा एतेन सच्चवज्जेन होतु नो जयमङ्गलम् एतेन सच्चवज्जेन पातु नो रतनत्तयम् नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स चक्कवरंकितरत्त सुपादो लक्कणमंडित आयतपाणि चामरचत्त विभूषित पादो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो सख्यकुमार वरो सुकुमालो लक्कण वित्तट पुण्य शरीरो लोकहिताय गतो नरवीरो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो पुण्यससंक निबो मुकवण्णो देवनरान पियो नरनागो मत्त गजिंद विलासित गामी ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो कत्तिय संभव अग्ग कुलीनो देवमनुस्स नमस्सित पादो शील समाधि पतिट्टित चित्तो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो आयत तुंग सुसंतितनासो गोपमुको अभिनील सुनेतो इंददनु अभिनील बमुको ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो वट्ट सुमट्ट सुसंतित गीवो सिंहहनु मिगराज शरीरो कंचन सुच्छ विवुत्तम वण्णो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो सुनिद्ध सुगंभीर मंजु सुगोसो हिंगुल बंधु सुरत्त सुजीवो वीसति वीसति सेत सुदंतो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो अंजन वण्ण सुनील सुकेशो कंचन पत्त विशुद्ध ललाटो ओषधि पंडर शुद्ध सुण्णो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो गच्छति नील पते वियचंदो तारगणा परिवेटित रूपो सावक मज्जगतो समनिंदो ये सहितु यपिता नरसिंहो एतेन सच्चवज्जेन सोतिनो होतु सब्बदा एतेन सच्चवज्जेन होतु नो जयमङ्गलम् एतेन सच्चवज्जेन पातु नो रतनत्तयं सब्बित्यो विभज्यन्तु सब्बरोगो विनशतु माते भवतंतरायो सुखी दीर्घायुको भव भवतु सब्बमङ्गलं रक्खन्तु सब्बदेवता सब्बबुद्धानुभावेन सब्बधम्मानुभावेन सब्बसंघानुभावेन सदा सोत्ति भवन्तु ते इमिना पुण्याकम्मेन मामे बालसमागमो सतं समागमो होतु यावनिब्बानपत्तिया इदं मे पुण्याकम्मं आसव क्रयं वहं होतु सब दुःखा मुच्यतु निब्बान संपच्चयो होतु साधु साधु साधु। So today these three chantings, one is mora paritta. Mora here, mor means mora, like in Hindi mor, peacock. It used to show respect and gratitude in the very morning itself, because I with the blessings of Tisarana, I had good sleep. I have the life now. I have got the life. I have started the new life. Every day, every morning is a new life for this, because it was a bodhisattva. It was our Buddha only. And it used to show the respect and the gratitude to those who protected this peacock, this bodhisattva. And also it used to pray for protection, in the sense like giving up ego and developing there some inclination, some orientation, shraddha, faith in Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. And also it used to show, the peacock used to show gratitude and respect to the sun also, because the sun gives energy and life to the earth, to all beings. So it used to show the gratitude to Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha and the sun in the morning once and in the evening once. So that much understanding that even that peacock had towards Buddha, towards liberation, towards enlightenment, towards mind purification, towards authoritative, right view mind purification. So that's what is chanted now. So in the morning, how he used to chant and go for work. And again in the evening when he comes back, how he used to chant and show his respect to Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, how he showed, he used to show faith, the inclination, the respect to liberation, the respect to mind purification, the respect to right view mind purification. Authoritative, right view, I am emphasizing as a synonym, as an equivalent to authoritativeness, correctly purifying. Each and every moment in that purification, you will not get any confusion, you will be clear, and you will get tremendous inner joy. Then only it becomes an authoritative mind purification. That's why right view mind purification is always an authoritative mind purification and liberation. That's what this bodhisattva used to chant in the morning and evening. That is what is mora parit. As a expression of gratitude, as an expression of conviction in this path, in this right view, as an expression of respect for getting this right view and this path of liberation. So that is first chanting. And the second one is Attavisati Buddha Vandana. Attavisati means, Visati means 20. Attavisati means 28. 28 Buddha Vandana. Showing gratitude not only to our Buddha, all Buddhas. So these 28 Buddhas, it is just symbolic representation of millions, so many Buddhas that have arisen in this world, that are arisen in this world, and then were going to arise in this world in the future. It is a symbolic representation, these 28 Buddhas. So it is not just our Buddha, the past Buddhas, the future Buddhas, that very Buddhatva we are showing our gratitude, our respect. We are showing our gratitude and respect to that quality, that Buddhatva, that authoritative mind liberation, using Buddhi and using, destroying this Buddhi, using Buddhi, destroying that, the Buddhi in the sense, destroying the mind, destroying the defilements of the mind, destroying the kleshas or the defilements of the mind, using our own Buddhi, which is already inherent in us. So that is what is Buddhatva. So we are showing gratitude and respect to this Buddhatva by remembering these 28 Buddhas and some unique qualities of these 28 Buddhas. So which will encompass all the Buddhas and that inherent quality of all the Buddhas, that is the Buddhatva, their passion, their inclination, their conviction, to authoritatively liberate the mind. So that we are worshipping, that we are showing gratitude, that we are praising, that we are worshipping, that we are showing respect to that. So what, if you show respect to something, automatically you progress in that. You will start getting that quality. That is a beauty of respecting. That is a beauty of gratitude. So if you start respecting, let us say, for example, health, if you start respecting health, then automatically your mind inclined towards health, and it will start learning about health, and you start practicing the different techniques that will keep your body and mind fit and to become healthy. So that is the quality of, that is the power of respecting. So be careful in respecting the people also. If you heartfully respect some person, then automatically you will start getting the qualities of that person. If you start respecting Buddha, then automatically you will start getting the qualities of Buddha. If you start respecting money, then automatically, genuinely, truly, if you start respecting money, then automatically there is a possibility of connecting with the different abilities, different virtues of money making. Then you will become rich. If you start respecting leadership, then there is a possibility of becoming a leader. So don't get carried away by these simple things, these petty things in the world. Start respecting the Buddha, the Buddhatva. Then automatically you will start getting the highest. Meanwhile, we'll start getting the other things also. You will not be devoid of either health or wealth or name and fame or any damn thing of this world. You will not lose. So that is the main emphasis of all true masters. They want to emphasize. So inclining towards the Buddhatva, respecting Buddhatva, being grateful to Buddhatva, so that you will get true inner joy, happiness, and start liberating the mind, and you will be happy now, happy hereafter, happy here, happy hereafter, happy now, happy afterwards also. And you will not lose those so many other things which are really required for us, for our body. Like health, wealth, and all these things are required for you. Those things also, you're not going to lose. So that's what is the emphasis of all the great masters, to encourage people, to encourage you to have gratitude, to have respect towards this authoritative right view, mind purification. Then, of course, Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha represent this right view, mind purification. So one should have this. Gratitude and respect to this, Tiratana, these three expressions of liberation, that is Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. That is what we have chanted in the second sutta, that is Attavisati Buddha Vandana. We remember 28 Buddhas, past Buddhas. Of course, all of them, they have this Buddhatva, they became Buddhas, they became Supreme Buddhas. But a few of but the path little bit varies from Buddha to Buddha. So one Buddha may emphasize more on, say, virya, with lot of energy. They became Buddhas by fulfilling their paramis with lot of energy, a lot of vigor, lot of, effort. And some Buddhas, they became Buddhas with lot of faith. They emphasized, they are faith-oriented Bodhisattvas. They become, with great faith, they become Buddhas. And many Buddhas, majority I think, they become Buddhas by buddhi, by wisdom, by developing more and more understanding, more and more clarity, more and more meditation. They become Buddhas. So though their paths slightly they vary, of course, all of them have all these qualities. All the Buddhas have faith, all the Buddhas have tremendous effort, all the Buddhas have tremendous wisdom. But one of them, it takes an upper hand in these different Buddhas. So so that's what is in this chanting. They highlighted the quality which is of in higher magnitude, you know, in these Buddhas that have been highlighted in this chanting. That we actually remembered by chanting this Attavisati Buddha Vandana. Then the last sutta that we chanted is this Narasiha Gata. Again, this Narasiha Gata. Rahula's mother, that is Yashodhara, she started expressing her faith, her respect towards Buddha, that is Rahula's father, and started, of course, she highlighted the Buddha's virtues, Buddha's abilities, Buddha's Shila Samadhi, how powerful he is in Shila and Samadhi. And in that way, she expressed her gratitude and respect to Buddha. At the same time, she induced those that kind of gratitude and respect in her son also, Rahula. Rahula is the son of Buddha and Yashodhara. So she highlighted the different great qualities of Buddha so that her son also should imbibe those qualities and get inspired by those qualities and emulate those qualities. That's what was her intention. So with that intention, she highlighted the different qualities of Buddha. And even his physical features also she highlighted, because some of the physical features one will get, especially the 32 qualities, the 32 features of great men. When their minds are perfect, then only they will get the physical features, because the body is very much, say, influenced by the mind and your thinking. If you have always evil thinking, then the body also becomes sick, or body also will lose attraction. If you have always, positive thinking and good thinking, then the body also becomes healthy, and there is charm in the body and the face. So to highlight that, highlight the importance of the mind, so she expressed her gratitude towards the physical features of Buddha also, and how those physical features are related, are connected to the purity of the mind. That's what is highlighted in this Narasiha Gatha, which was actually proclaimed by this Yashodhara, Rahula's mother. So these three things, these three chantings, these three suttas, they highlight the importance of gratitude, importance of respect, importance of faith in this right view, mind cultivation and liberation. So that's what we chanted. Now you take five precepts, those who want to take five precepts, and then some of you want to take eight precepts, I can give eight precepts also. Or let us see, if anybody is interested, you can take eight precepts. Then we'll practice meditation for some 5 minutes to develop this attitude of gratitude. And then we take up this Brahmajala Sutta just for a few minutes. And then you can ask questions. Okay, now if some of you are interested in taking five precepts, you can just repeat after me. How many of you are interested in taking five precepts? Please raise your hands so that I will get some idea. Oh, Prakash, Arvind, Ravi, Nina, Vaishali. Some of you can take eight precepts also. If some of you are interested, you can take eight precepts also. Eight precepts, voila, no need to raise hand. Afterwards, I will ask you. Five precepts, first we will see five precepts. Seven participants raised hand. Okay. Rajasvini also wants to take five precepts or eight precepts? Vikas Party, yeah. Okay. So, those who want to take five precepts, you just repeat after me. Of course, you need not unmute. It is for you actually. Now we can't make it like in physical meeting. Everybody can chant together, but here, if there is some difficulty, you can do it by yourself. But you can say loudly in your place. You can say loudly, no problem. नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा
नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा
ओके नाउ दोस वांट टू टेक फाइव प्रिसेप्ट्स यू प्लीज टर्न ऑन द वीडियो Those who are taking five precepts, you please turn on the video. Just mute your audios. Please mute, it will create some disturbance. ओ कासा अहंग बंते तिसरणेन सह पंचशीलं धम्मंग्या चामि अनुग्रहं कत्वा शीलं देता मे बंते द्वितीयंपि ओ कासा अहंग बंते तिसरणेन सह पंचशीलं धम्मंग्या चामि अनुग्रहं कत्वा शीलं देता मे बंते तृतीयंपि ओ कासा अहं बंते तिसरणेन सह पंचशीलं धम्मंग्या चामि अनुग्रहं कत्वा शीलं देता मे बंते अनुकंपं upadaya you can say loudly in your place yamahang vadami ama bante then I will say yamahang vadami tang vadeta then you can say ama bante and then namo tassa bhagavato arhato samma sambuddhassa you can say this for three times namo tassa bhagavato arhato samma sambuddhassa नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा नमो तस्सा भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्सा थ्री टाइम्स यू कैन से बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि यू कैन जस्ट रिपीट आफ्टर मी धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि संघं शरणं गच्छामि द्वितीयंपि बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि द्वितीयंपि धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि द्वितीयंपि संघं शरणं गच्छामि तृतीयंपि बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि तृतीयंपि धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि तृतीयंपि संघं शरणं गच्छामि तिसरणगमनं परिपूर्णं You can say Amabante. Panatipata Veramani Sikapadang Samadhiyami Adinnadana Veramani Sikapadang Samadhiyami Kame Sumichachara Veramani Sikapadang Samadhiyami Usavada Veramani Sikapadang Samadhiyami सुरामेरया मज्जा पमादट्ठाना वे रमणी सिक्कापदं समाधियामि सो ऑल द फाइव पंचशीला इज ओवर तिसरणेन सह पंचशीलं अपमादेन संपदेता अपमादेन so all of you appamadena means like with all mindfulness you should rakkanti you should protect it you should preserve it nobody will practice panchashila for yourself you only have to practice panchashila for yourself so practice this panchashila with awareness with alertness with mindfulness appamada means mindfulness so that mindfulness and morality they go together So if you are mindful, then automatically with that alertness, you maintain morality. You will be conscious. It is good for me, good for others. I should not break this, so that it is good for everyone. So if you practice morality, your mindfulness automatically will be increased. So that is the main reason why I have to give this mind, this Panchashila in this program. Actually, if possible, if you are interested, every Sunday also you can take maybe from next time, because morality, mindfulness, and moderation, middle path, these things go together. All these M's, three M's, they go together. Mindfulness, moderation, this mind-centered middle path, and then morality. These things go together. So that is the beauty of morality. That's what is highlighted even in this Brahmajala Sutta. So all of you have taken these five precepts. Follow this with appamada, with mindfulness, with conviction. Okay. Now, if some of you are interested in 8 Shila, please raise your hand. Panchashila, you just down your hand, so that I will come to know who are all 8 Shila. 8 Shila people. Deepali, Prachi Patil. Vaishali wants to take 8 Shila. Astashila. Yeah, so three of you, right? Okay. Now you can take 8 precepts. Okasa ahang bante tisarne nasaha aktashilang dhammang yachami anugahang katwa shilang deta me bante dutiyampi okasa ahang bante tisarne nasaha aktashilang dhammang yachami anugahang katwa shilang deta me bante Tatiyampi Okasa Ahangbante Tisarnena Saha Attashilang Dhammangya Chami Anugahang Katwa Shilang Deta Me Bante Anukampang Upadhaya Yamahangvadami Tangvadeta Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhasa. 3 times you can tell this. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Buddhang saranam gacchami. Dhammang saranam gacchami. Sanghang saranam gacchami. Dutiyampi buddhang saranam gacchami. Dutiyampi dhammang saranam gacchami. Dutiyampi sangham saranam gacchami. Tatiyampi buddham saranam gacchami. Tatiyampi dhammam saranam gacchami. Tatiyampi sangham saranam gacchami. Tisarana gamanam paripurnam. You can say amma bante and go down once. Prachi, you can turn on your video. If there is some problem, no need. Otherwise, you can better turn on the video. Okay, now you take 8 precepts. Panatipata veramani sikka padang samadhiyami. Adinnadana veramani sikka padang samadhiyami. Abrahmacharya veramani sikka padang samadhiyami. Musavada veramani sikha padang samadhiyami. Sura meraya majja pamadatthana veramani sikha padang samadhiyami. Vikala bojana veramani sikha padang samadhiyami. Natcha gita vadita visokadasana mala ganda vilepana dharana mandana vibhusanatthana veramani sikkapadam samadhiyami. उच्चशयना महाशयना वेरमणि सिक्खापदं समाधियामि। साधु साधु साधु। अट्ठंग शीलं धम्मं साधुकं सुरक्षितं कत्वा अपमादेन संपदेता। साधु साधु। सुखी रहे, मंगल हो। प्लीज गिव सम इंपॉर्टेंस टू दिस शीला आल्सो। शीलो रक्षति रक्षिता। इफ यू प्रोटेक्ट शीला, शीला विल प्रोटेक्ट यू। आई हैव टोल्ड यू शीला इज ऑलवेज रिलेटेड टू दिस मॉडरेशन, माइंडफुलनेस एंड दिस mind centeredness, that is right view. If you are correctly practicing shila, whether it is five shila or eight shila, whatever it is, even one or two shila also, if you are seriously understood and practicing it, then it will take your mind towards this mind centeredness, mindfulness. Automatically your mindfulness will increase, automatically your understanding, your right view, your overall comprehension of Buddha's teachings through this right view, not to take extreme views, not to fall into the trap of wrong views, this idea of moderation in all sensual things or in this world, how to achieve moderation in all aspects, all this wisdom also will develop. That is the power of morality. Morality is like the base. If you practice this with understanding, then it will take your mind in this step-by-step progress, and you establish very well in both mindfulness and also in this right view, mind-centeredness. That means you will establish in right views. You will be free from wrong views, slowly, slowly, bit by bit. Okay, so that is the importance of taking these five precepts and eight precepts. Now we will practice 5 minutes meditation. Develop these qualities of gratitude. And this is gratitude giving and respect showing meditation. It's almost like your wholesome feelings meditation only. So we'll practice this for 5 minutes. Close your eyes. Sit comfortably. See yourself sitting peacefully in meditation. Keep a smile on your face. All these 4 months, I have practiced meditation. I have practiced the right view, the Dhamma, learned Dhamma. And established, keep on establishing this right view bit by bit. So feel happy for that. Rejoice in these wholesome actions that you have practiced from these 4 months. And wish yourself, let me be like this with lot of joy, this rejoicefulness, by practicing wholesome actions, meritorious actions. Let me be happy and well. Let me be healthy and peaceful. Let me progress in this path of mind purification, right view and right view meditations. Now you see, when you remember that you have practiced something good, how happy you become. And now again you show gratitude and respect to the teacher and to all other people who helped you to gain this. And then after that, just see how the mind becomes much more happy much more joyful, much more rejoicefulness you will get. My teacher, my master, who helped me to progress in this right view and mind purification. And all others, like my co-meditators, my family members, and other volunteers and coordinators, the core coordinators, the course coordinators, all my near and dear ones, my friends, directly or indirectly, who helped me. All the known people and all the unknown people also, directly and indirectly, who might have helped me. All humans and all other beings, this whole existence. I'm grateful. To all these people who helped me and all other beings. And also I'm respectful to the masters and all the other masters of this lineage, all the Buddhas, Buddha and all the Buddhas. Now, and the Sangha of all the Buddhas, and the teachers, masters of this lineage, I'm respectful, I'm grateful. With this gratitude and respect, may I develop more conviction, more wisdom to progress in this path. May I be happy, healthy, and peaceful. May my master also be happy, healthy, and peaceful. Let him progress in this path, mind purification, right view meditations. Let him always be a support for us, and we will be a support for him. And all the team, we will support and let them be a support for me. May all of them be happy, healthy, and peaceful. May all the people in this whole world who are developing this gratitude and respect, all of them be happy, healthy, and peaceful and progress in this path. All the masters and all the teachers are helping these people to establish in this right view and right view meditations, in this mind purification, Dhamma. All of them also be happy, healthy, and peaceful and progress in this path. May all the people, may all the beings, may all the animals and all the beings in this whole universe be happy, healthy, and peaceful unconditionally. I'm radiating my loving kindness and compassion and appreciation to all the beings in this whole universe. I'm also wishing all beings establish this right view. Good begets good, bad begets bad. Let them develop this wisdom. With this wish, your mind becomes equanimous, upekkha. And see, your mind is full of metta, karuna, mudita, upekkha. But also full of gratitude and respect. Let me be like this always, with my mind full of this Brahma Viharas, Metta Karuna Mudita Upekkha. But also my mind full of gratitude and respect towards this path. and the master and the Sangha group, which is helping me to establish this path. Once again, you see yourself sitting peacefully in meditation with a smile on your face, the mindful of these wholesome feelings, the strong, very positive, very wholesome feelings, gratitude and respect. You are completely soaked in these feelings of gratitude and respect. Your deep emotions, it may outburst or it may in the form of tears also. Just soak in these feelings of Brahma Viharas and this gratitude, respect. Towards this path, towards the master, towards the Sangha group. How fortunate I am. To take birth in this Buddha Sasana time. To get this right view, to get this wisdom and freedom. Let me be like this. Always let me progress this path. Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkantu sabba devata sabba buddhanu bhavena sabba dhammanu bhavena sabba sanghanu bhavena sadasotti bhavantute sadhu sadhu sadhu. So in that way, so you can practice this soft feelings, the wholesome feelings, metta karana mudra with upekkha, and in addition, along with that, if you practice gratitude and respect, then it will become much more effective way of establishing in this wholesome emotions. And it will definitely cleanse our heart, a lot of our eye-centeredness, or I-ness, my-ness, which are the roots of all our suffering, that will melt to a great extent. So that is actually the purpose of these wholesome feelings and mindfulness training, and for that matter, all spirituality. So practicing this attitude and respect is also one very powerful tool to melt our minus and minus, and also to purify our mind and to progress in this path. That is the meditation that we practiced now. Now just for some 5-10 minutes, we will see this. Just some 5-10 minutes, we will summarize what we have learned in this Brahmajala Sutta as a continuation of our discussion in this Nama Talks. We have to continue with our discussion and then you can ask questions. So what we have learned in this Brahmajala Sutta, so the people with a lot of wrong views only, they blame Buddha. If the person turns into right view, if he establishes in right view, then he can't blame Buddha. Then automatically he surrenders to Buddha, because he is the personification of right view. Buddha is the personification of right view. right view personified is Buddha. So once you establish in right view by giving up wrong views, then automatically they can understand all Buddha's teachings. So when some people started blaming one teacher and one disciple, the teacher started blaming, then Buddha told that these are his disciples, Buddha's disciples. Don't argue with those people. Don't fight with those people. Don't quarrel with anybody. If somebody praises you, you just accept. And why they are praising, you just teach them, educate them. If somebody blames you, why their blame is futile. It is, there is no meaning in their blame. You just teach them. That's all you should do. When somebody praises, somebody teases, there is no need to react to them, either with, say, excitement or with depression, disappointment. You need not react. You just accept it with equanimous mind, and you just prove it. You just reason it for the praise and the blame. You just give the reasons why it is you are praiseworthy, why it is not blameworthy, that you should reason it. That's what is your duty. That's what Buddha says. And then he says, morality, as I was telling you, is the basis for understanding right view. Correctly understanding morality will lead to correct understanding of right view. So he explains the different levels of morality. And that also you can explain to these other sects. People are, almost all sects are interested in morality. But if you explain it, the authenticity or the why aspect of morality, why the Buddhas and the Buddha's followers, they practice morality, if you explain it and the different levels of morality you explain, then definitely they will be inspired by that, and there is a possibility of learning right view through morality by those other sectarians. In that way you can teach them. So he explains about the different levels of morality in an authoritative way, Buddha, in this Brahmajala Sutta. And then next he explains 62 kinds of wrong views. The first 18 views are about the past, previous lives. And the next 44 views that we are going to discuss is about the future life. People have this always, though we are in this world, in this moment, we are living now in this life, but always we are worried about the past lives and the future lives. Always we have some doubt about this. And some meditators or some yogis or some spiritual people, by practicing meditation, you can able to know the past lives. They have developed 4 kinds of wrong views because they could not thoroughly investigated their mind. Partially or imperfectly, they have investigated their mind. So they end up in 4 kinds of wrong views, eternalistic wrong views. If they see a few previous lives, they conclude in one way of eternalism. This world is permanent. And if they would be able to see the previous kalpa also, the previous eon, the earth has destroyed, and again it came into existence, it was evolved. So that is called one eon. So those who could see some eons, some kalpas, they come to know, they think that this existence and me, especially me, is permanent, or that Atma is permanent. So, and some yogis, some meditators, they could see not just one kalpa, several thousands of kalpas, and they establish in one kind of wrong view. And some logically they derive all these things. So everything is there, existence is there, somebody might have created this. Like many of these theists, present atheists, like theistic, other religious people, God-centered religions. Oh, all this world is there, all this beautiful organized world is there, so much, it is so well organized. Who can do other than this? Who can do this this much of organized universe other than God? In that way, some people logically, they conclude that there is God, the God has created this. So that is also wrong view. In that way, these 4 wrong views, or the first 4 wrong views are related to eternalistic views, or Shashvatavada, Shashvatavada. Eternalism means like there is permanence in this world. That permanence is because of soul and supreme soul. In that way, they conclude. So these first are the eternalistic wrong views. The second 4, that means the wrong view number 5 to wrong view number 8. They are called partial eternalistic views. Again, when you get jhanas, when you see the previous lives, and when you see the Brahmic worlds means like there are different kinds of worlds. There are 31 planes of existence. So the Brahmas, they look permanent. We are not permanent. The creator God is Brahma. That way they concluded. That is what is called partial eternalistic views. That's what many Hindus, the Brahma-centered Hindus, they have this partial eternalistic views also. That's why they think that Brahma is the creator God. Buddha says, of course, Buddha, he argues and he proves to one of the Brahmas, Bhaka Brahma, that he is not permanent. He could prove it very authoritatively. And then his wrong view was removed. It is called eternalistic, partial eternalistic wrong view. Partial eternalistic view. And that is also wrong view. Again, by assessing their previous lives based on their meditative abilities, in 4 levels, people develop this kind of wrong view also, this partial eternalistic wrong view. Even with analytical thinking, logic also, some people develop this eternalistic, this partial eternalistic wrong view. So these are 4 plus 4, 8 wrong views. 4 are about eternalistic wrong views, 4 are about partial eternalistic wrong views. And again, some people develop wrong views about the world and the existence and the universe, not just across the time. So these eternalistic, partial eternalistic wrong views, they're across the time in the previous lives, across the space also, whether the space is say finite or infinite. So they develop different kinds of wrong views. So if you attain 4 jhanas, as I was telling you last time, the first 4 jhanas, first jhana, second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana, you develop this finiteness. The world is finite. And if you establish, if you say get this 5th to 8th jhanas, there are totally 8 jhanas. So 5th to 8th jhanas, they are called arupa jhanas. Then you think that the world is infinite. So in that way, some people develop through meditation only. They are not bluffing. They are not like, say, boasting. They are not selfish. It's only because of their imperfect observation, they conclude, they deduce this kind of wrong views. So these rupa jhanas, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th jhanas, those who get, they conclude that world is finite. And those who could get this arupa jhanas, 5th to 8th jhanas, they could conclude that the world is infinite. But both are wrong views. You can't conclude like that. You can't say either whether it is finite or infinite. They are wrong views. That's what Buddha says. And again, there are one more set of meditators who are well-versed in this. Sometimes they find this as finite. Sometimes they find this as infinite. They conclude the world is both finite and infinite. That is also wrong view. In that way, one should not conclude. And then a few people with their logic, they will conclude that world is neither finite nor infinite. That is also wrong view. About the world, finally, what you have to learn, you should not bother about this world. That is none of your business. That is none of the priorities for a wise man. For a wise man, that is not the priority. Only some stupid, some curious, childlike people. No, they are bothered about the world and the galaxies and how finite it is, how infinite it is. All these things that is beyond human intellect. So a few things which are beyond human intellect, we should be only experienced through completely, thoroughly practicing these meditation techniques and becoming arahant. Then you will come to know about the finiteness, infiniteness of the world, about the previous lives, about the future lives, everything you will come to know. So at this juncture, when you are, say, practicing meditation, and you have not reached that complete, say, thoroughness in meditation, you should not think about those things. You should not conclude in any way. Then it will lead to wrong views. Your first priority, your first preference is to purify your mind and to come out of suffering. As I was giving you a lot of similes last time. A a few things, so world is full of, so many things are there. If you start bothering about all those things, then you will go mad. Always one should work for the priorities. If you want to know about this, if you want to know about that, if you want to know about machines, if you want to know about medicines, if you want to know about geography, if you want to know about everything, then you will end up in nowhere and you will be more confused and you may go mad also. And if your curiosity, because your time limit, your life is, say, it is fixed. There is no much time. So you simply distract your mind and you will go mad. So that's what is Buddha's conclusion. So one should prioritize the life, prioritize the knowledge also, prioritize the sadhana, your efforts also. Don't simply waste your life in being curious of 1 million things where you end up in nowhere if you have that kind of childish curiosity. So that is what is the next 4 wrong views about the space, about the world. The first set of eternalistic views and these partial eternalistic views are about the time. And the last set, the third set, is about the space, the finiteness and the infiniteness of the world. That is also futile. If you want to know about that, that will end up in the futility. It is a futile exercise. You will not comprehend it. You can't comprehend it. It can't be comprehended with this kind of imperfect meditation or imperfect achievement in the meditation, and through logic you can't comprehend. If you comprehend, if you think that you have comprehended, you will develop the wrong view. So these are the 12 wrong views. Okay, another 6 wrong views are also about the previous lives only. What you have what you have realized through your meditation. And after that, after 18 wrong views, the next 44 wrong views are about the future. So 18 wrong views are about your past lives, your atma, your permanent, whether you are permanent or whether you are not permanent or you are semi-permanent, this space is whether finite or infinite. So these things you are going to learn through your meditation, through your observation in the meditation. So that's why they come under the category of previous life's observation or previous time observation. So there are 18 in that. And after that, about the future, it will come. So before going into that, there is something called, there are 6 more wrong views. So I think today, will not take up those things because we don't have time. So now this much, these 12 wrong views, be thorough with these 12 wrong views, and then next other 6 wrong views we will see, and then we can take up the wrong views about the future also in this series of lectures, series of Dhamma talks about this Brahmajala Sutta. If you go fast, then it will be like, say, more confusing. If you go very slow also, that will be more confusing. So on moderate speed, moderate approach we should practice here. So please understand the different kinds of wrong views, which are very much there even today. This is now, these wrong views, they are like almost eternal. Truth is like, say, there, it's always the people who are working on truth, who have realized truth, are very, very less in number. Their percentage is very, very less. These wrong views are more prevalent, more, obvious in this human world. Because all these wrong views, they arose from, this defilement only. These 3 defilements only, Lobha, Dosa, Moha, or wrong views. Because you want to be in this world only, that's why you start thinking about eternalistic views or partial eternalistic views. Or you want to become curious and you have to have this ego of, I know about the space. With that childish ego, you develop these remaining 4 views about finiteness and infiniteness. So all these wrong views, they arise from our defilements only. So once we establish in absolute state of no defilements, complete purity in the mind, then only you will realize, then you will only will establish in the absolute right view. But if you follow the masters who have established in right view, then slowly, slowly we can progress in right view. And our kleshas, our defilements will step by step, bit by bit, they will melt, they will reduce. That is the objective of all these exercises that we are doing now. Whether it is Dhamma talks or meditations in different levels or meditation practice sessions or the different meritorious actions that you take up, like Dana, Shila, you have practiced Pancha, this the Pancha Shila and Ashta Shila you have taken, and you are giving service, many of you, in the form of promoting this right view meditations, conducting practice sessions, and you are giving Dana, and you are listening to Dhamma, Dhamma Desana, and now we conduct this Punya Anumodana also. In that way, in all these different meritorious actions also will help us to establish in right view and reduce defilements, purify the mind, and understanding these wrong views, the different wrong views correctly, as explained in this Brahmajala Sutta. That will also help us to reduce our defilements and establish in right view. So that is the idea. So before you ask questions, we will do this Punya Anumodana also. Or maybe first you ask questions, then as a final, part of this program, we will do Punya Anumodana. Because asking questions is also, it's one of the Punya, Dhamma Sakaccha, you know. Remember? So listening to Dhamma is Dhamma Savana, and asking questions and discussing is Dhamma Sakaccha. So Dhamma Savana and Dhamma Sakaccha, both are Punyas. So we'll practice this this other Punya Kriya also, this Dhamma Sakaccha, you ask questions. Then almost all Dittijukamma, that is about establishing in right view, that we are doing in this Dhamma, this Brahmajala Sutta. This is also called Dittijala Sutta. That means understanding different dittis, wrong views. So understanding wrong views and establishing right view, that is called Dittijukamma, that is the 10th meritorious action. So today I think almost all meritorious actions we are going to practice, and then we will do Punya Anumodana. Then it will become more effective. Okay?
Vandame Mante.
If you have questions, yeah, you can ask. Yes,
Super Sir. Vandame Mante.
Super Sir.
I am Vijay Ranpise.
Yes, Super Sir.
Mante ji, for so many days I was having this question. See, when the Buddha, Sambhavabuddha, Sammasambuddha or Arhant, they don't get the another birth. So then how this Buddhas, so many Buddhas appeared or have their birth?
See, yeah, let us say, it's very simple. Let us say now our Gautama Buddha, in his previous lives, he was Bodhisattva. He determined to become Buddha, and so many lives he developed his mind by practicing a lot of meritorious actions, developing paramis, perfections of the mind, and he became Buddha, and he disappeared from this existence. By looking at him, some other person will get inspiration. At the time of Buddha, there were so many people, they decided to become Buddhas. They list some 10 people who are Bodhisattvas who decided to become Buddhas at the time of Buddha. One is like this king, Prasenjit, the king of that province. His name was Prasenadi, he decided to become Buddha. And an elephant, Parileka elephant, and one person by name Todaya, and his son Subha, and one monkey. In that way, some 10 beings, they decided to become Buddhas. They are considered as Bodhisattvas. And Buddha, of course, he didn't tell anybody that he will become future Buddha. But in the scriptures, it is mentioned. So if they can become Buddhas. Now, for example, this Pasenadi, let us take. This King Pasenadi. So in the next life, he will work on his mind. He will develop right view and he will purify his mind. and then will completely life after life, life after life, like our Bodhisattva Gautama Buddha. After maybe so many kalpas, he may become Buddha and he will liberate from this world. He will disappear from this world. The same way, this Todaya and Subha and this Parilayaka, all of them, they may work on their mind, and after so many millions of kalpas, they too may become Buddhas and they may disappear. And some Bodhisattvas may be working now and they may be in this divine realms. Our Buddha, before coming here and to become Buddha, like Siddhartha, he appeared here. He was in Tushita heaven as the king of the Tushita heavenly plane. So now also there may be some Bodhisattvas who are waiting there in the Tushita heaven. Or maybe in some Brahmas also may be waiting. And after some time, they too may appear on the earth. And they become Buddhas. So in that way, it is not one Buddha who appears and who becomes Buddha and then he disappears. So by looking at him, many people, even you can also decide to become Buddha. I can also decide. Or some other person also can decide. Anybody can decide to become Buddha and work on that. And he should completely purify his mind. Simply, he should not boast that, yes, I am Bodhisattva, I am pure. That is what is the misery with this, some Buddhists in some countries. Actually, one should not express, even the Bodhisattvas, they never express that they are Bodhisattvas. If you express, then that resolution and that conviction will go away. One should see his abilities and his conviction and his focus and his dispassion towards otherworldly things. All these things one should assess and one should see one living Buddha or Buddha Sasana like this and get enthused, get inspired by the qualities of the Buddha and compassion of the Buddha and the wisdom of the Buddha. And one should decide and get the blessings of the one Sama Buddha, and he can also become a Bodhisattva and work on his mind, and he can become a Buddha. That way anybody can become a Buddha. Even animals can decide to become. If the animal's mind is so much mature. Even our Buddha was also an animal in so many lives when he was Bodhisattva, because he wanted to fulfill some of the perfections. So he found some animal's body suitable. So he took animal's body, he took life. I mean, he was born as, he can't do, the karma will take the course. So he became an animal and he fulfilled some perfections. That way, parmis are the perfections. One should fulfill all the 10 parmis correctly, with all conviction, with all wisdom, with all humbleness, with all humility. Then anybody can become Buddha. So in that way, many have become Buddhas because in this existence, many Buddhas have come. Many Buddhas going to come, going to appear in this world. So that's how. It's not like you are avatars, like in Hinduism they say, no, Vishnu, he was Matsya, then he became Kurma, then he became tortoise. First he was a fish. Also, it's only one person. It's not like that reincarnation theory. And he disappears and again he will come back as. That is not the point. Here it is, anybody can become Buddha. Based on his mental conviction, mental abilities, by fulfilling the parmis, the perfections. And it's not like other religions like Christianity and Islam, where only one creator God is there. One should submit his will to that creator God. He sends some of his representatives or his son or somebody to help the world. Again, that is not the view here. You can also become Buddha, help yourself, help others. He can also become Buddha. He can help himself, help others, work on his mind, develop his right view conviction, progress in this path of right view. So that kind of free will, that kind of right view, very much there. It's not like one fixed, rigid views. So many kinds of wrong views only, so many religions. Of course, let us not bother about, let us not say blame or bother about other religions or other views. Because we are discussing about wrong views, I have to give some examples. So I am giving that. Otherwise, I don't have any kind of, ego or some kind of ill will towards other views. That's how their karma, their punya works, and that's how they are there. But we can't help. We just wish them to be happy. And if possible, we can help them. Otherwise, let them continue with their wrong view. Coming to your question, anybody can become Buddha. And if there are so many people here with a lot of different levels of mind maturity, so then number of Buddhas have come and then number of Buddhas will come. So that's how.
Thank you, Vandana Bhantaji. Another question connected to this only. See, that means
there are you clear with this? Are you clear with this?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes,
because
yes,
you are yes, telling yes, that yes, the question was there in your mind from so many days. Now it
is. Yes, yes. So another question connected with this only. See, that means there is no rebirth. Is that correct?
That means no rebirth means like what? For Buddhas, no rebirth. Already in Buddha and like our for example, for our Gautama Buddha, no rebirth. And for Kassapa Buddha, the previous Buddha, no rebirth. Yeah.
Then how this Buddha revealed that his life, he was looking at so many Buddhas.
That is possible. So in his meditation, so the mind, as I told you, it has tremendous dimensions. It has tremendous powers. It can penetrate across the time. Across the time means like a matured mind, a pure mind. It can penetrate 10 lives, 20 lives, 50 lives, 100 lives, millions of lives it could penetrate. And it could penetrate the future also. So he could penetrate his previous lives and so many previous lives also he could penetrate, and he could see, he encountered so many other Buddhas, Dhamma Sambuddhas, so that he, as a memory, it comes to him. As a memory, it is there in his mind, so that he could see. Those Buddhas, let us say he encountered Kassapa Buddha in his meditation, as a thought it comes. It is not reality, it's just a thought, it's a memory. Memory is not real. If he has encountered Kassapa Buddha, it doesn't mean that Kassapa Buddha is there. It is a memory of he encountering Kassapa Buddha. That's all. So when I say, I can remember my father now, but my father is not there. So it doesn't mean that my memory of father means that my father is there. Is it not? So it is just memory of Kassapa Buddha, that's previous Buddha, that he could see in his meditation. But it doesn't mean that Kassapa Buddha is still there. You got my point?
Yes.
Is it clear?
Yes. Thank you, Vandana Bhantaji. I'm very delighted and very with gratitude, deepest gratitude. I thank you very much.
But what is your question, right?
Yes, sir.
With the previous Buddhas, if they are not there, then how Buddha can remember them? It's because it is just a memory. It is not the reality of that he encountered the Buddha now. No, it is his previous encounter of the previous Buddha. As a memory, it is there. Through meditation, he could remember that. That's it. So in that way, once you become Arahant, once you become Buddha, that's it. It's like Buddha gives the example of blowing off or extinguishing one flame. One flame, if you say, it will blow off. It's just extinguished. In the same way, the Arahants and Buddhas also. So their mission is fulfilled. They have completely purified their mind. Their mind is completely free from all the defilements, lobha, dosa, moha. Completely they are extinguished. So when the fuel is not there, then the light will not burn. Is it not? The lamp will not burn. When the fuel is gone, it's completely extinguished. The lamp also gone. It will blow off. The same way in these Arahants and Buddhas, the fuel. What is the fuel? Our own defilements. Our own defilements only will push to take other birth, next birth, next birth. If the fuel is completely removed, completely it is destroyed by this wisdom, by the practice of all these right few techniques, then what happens? The fuel will completely it is extinguished. Then there is no when. Go from one line, push us to take birth after birth. So when you work on the defilements, lobha, dosa, moha, and completely destroy them, annihilate them, then automatically there is no rebirth. That's what the Buddhas and Arhants do. That's what is the mission of Buddhas also. That's what we are doing also. Why we are practicing meditation and Dhamma and meritorious actions and all these things? To reduce our defilements. By reducing our defilements, grossness will reduce, we become more and more subtle, we enjoy more and more subtle happiness, and slowly, slowly, we transcend even this body and mind, and we enjoy this absolute nibbanic bliss. Then there is no body, no mind, no rebirth. So that is the right view approach to understand how these defilements are the cause of suffering, cause of say birth, and by destroying these defilements, how births can be destroyed. Okay, good.
Thank you. Thank you, Vandana. Vandana, Vandana.
Sukhi. Sukhi, Vandana. Okay, any other question? Last question.
Vandana, Vandana.
Sadhu, Sukhi, Vandana, Upasak.
I am Rajesh Vandana, Vandana.
Yes, Rajesh Vandana.
Bhanteji, when Lord Buddha has delivered his first lecture, Dhamma Chakka Pavatan Sutta at Varanasi, at the end of the lecture, it is told that his word has reached to 10,000 Chakravala world. Means what is mean by that,
Bhanteji? Chakravalas means world systems. Like, like say now people say galaxy and all, no? You can say galaxy as one Chakravala. So we are in this Milky Way galaxy. So we belong to this Milky Way galaxy. In the same way, there are millions of galaxies. So this Buddha's first discourse, it reached to 10,000 galaxies. That's what is the meaning of Chakravala. And 18 crore Brahmas, they became liberated. They became Arhants. So coming to your question, Chakravala means galaxy. Next question.
Thank you.
Vandami Banteji.
Your name?
Arvind Shend. Arvind Shend.
Arvind Shend, yes, super. Arvind Shend.
Banteji, I have got one question because I was studying in a university for some time, some certificate course, just to learn something about it. I was told there by that ego is also one of the God.
Sorry?
Ego is also one of the God.
One of the God?
Yeah. Is it correct or wrong?
Absolutely wrong. This is absolute nonsense. Who told this?
One of the lecturers. He said there are so many levels of gods, like Mara and so many. Mm. Even he considered Mara as a God. And said ego is also one of the God. So that's why it is there in the people. So it did not appeal to me properly, and I thought I should ask you actually whether it is or it is not. By common sense, it is not a God. To my mind, it cannot be a God, because the ego itself destroys the person and the people are surrounding it. So, but it has been told. So I was trying to understand what it is actually.
Of course, ego is there in all life. When you take a form, like either as a divine being or as a human being or as an animal, with ego only. Avijja pachaya sankara, sankara pachaya vijnana. Sankara means actually ego. Through ignorance, ego comes. Through that ego only, vijnana. Vijnana means the life, the consciousness comes. Wherever there is life, wherever there is a living being, whether it is Brahmic being or divine being or human being or animal. So there, of course, because of ego only, we have taken the forms of these different forms. Of course, divine beings also, they have ego. And so in that way, the problem with these theistic religions, especially this polytheistic religion like Hinduism, they worship some qualities and they personify it as a god. For example, Rama, Krishna, or say Krishna is the symbol of universal love. So universal love he has, that's why he has expressed his universal love in a very authoritative way. So they made him a god. They made him as a god. But again, of course, as I told you, each and every being, whether it's divine being with some ego of universal love, universal consciousness only, he worked and he became, is considered as god. So in that way, whether it is the different gods that different people talk about in different religions, even in Buddhism also, there are different gods in different planes of existence. They have this ego only. But it is not like, it's not one godly quality. It is not one divine quality. It may be there in all divine beings. The ego is there in all divine beings. Just like in human beings, the ego may be a little strong. In animals, it may be much more strong because of ignorance. But ego is ego. It definitely brings suffering. But lesser the ego, greater the understanding of ego, then greater the freedom from the suffering of ego, from the bondage of ego. In that sense, of course, ego is there in all divine beings, in all human beings, but ego is not one divine quality. The divine quality is like, say, compassion, like, say, loving kindness, like, say, universal love, or say, or appreciation, or respect, or gratitude. These are the divine qualities. So when you are talking about the divine beings with regard to their divine qualities, then you should not bring in this ego. You should not bring in this ego, because ego is always a negative quality. Higher the ego, higher the negativity. So in that classification, in that sector, in that segment, you should not bring the divinity. Divinity is always like your beautiful qualities, the wholesome qualities like compassion. Higher the compassion, higher the divinity. Higher the ego, lower the divinity. In that way, ego is actually the inversely proportional to divinity. Compassion, appreciation, loving kindness, they are directly proportional to divinity. In that way, we should define divinity. You should not bring in this negative quality of ego into this divinity, into this domain of divinity. Is it not, Upasak Arvind Shinde?
Yes, Teji, correct. That's correct. To my common sense, it did not appeal properly.
Correct.
As a student, I had to keep quiet, actually. Well, okay. I did not have much of a knowledge, actually. So what to say? But it was there in my mind, actually, to know how to resolve this issue. Now I got it resolved. Thank you, Bhante.
Sorry, one more question.
Onnam Bhanteji.
Yes, Supas.
I'm Dr.
Venkat. Yes. Yes, Supas.
Bhanteji, my doubt is a tree will generate a seed. In this world, the seed will become a tree. Tree will die. Seed will lead with this environmental things. It will become a tree and it will again give seed. Like the defilement, by nullifying the defilement, you will become Buddha. Isn't it? I want to clarify it. So that means, is it a possibility of getting rebirth of a Buddha? like the trees, a tree is generated from the seed. Again, tree will give seed. Like that, the defilements in the human being or any creature, by nullifying the defilements, he will become Buddha.
Yes.
So that means it is ended. Defilement and defilements ended, are ended, he will become Buddha.
Yeah.
So is the possibility of regenerating the Buddha and starting with the zero defilement? I mean, with defilement.
No.
Like tree.
No. See, your example of tree and seed also, in that seed, there is your chemicals, your DNA, it is designed to make it into a tree. But here, once you become Buddha, all these defilements are nothing but those DNA, or those chemicals, or those inherent things. All those things will be destroyed. Then there is no possibility of again coming to this world, again coming to any of these 31 planes of the existence in this world. So he will reach what is called that Nibbana. Once you reach that Nibbana, that's it. There is no need. Why should he come back? What is the need of he to come back? The very purpose of human life is to become Buddha and get lost from this dirty world. What is the need to come back to this world? By looking at your commitment to become Buddha, other people get inspired and they will also work on themselves and they also get rid of this stupid world and they become Buddhas. And why you should come back after becoming a Buddha? There's no need. Because coming back itself is suffering. The world is suffering. Why should I fall into this dirtiness of suffering of this in this world? If we understand this first noble truth that this worldliness, this 31 planes of existence is suffering, then nobody will like to be in this 31 planes. That's why Buddha, very authoritatively, he just declared, world is suffering, my dear people. Get rid of this world. For that, work on these lines, step by step, work on these lines and get lost from this world. And that's what is my path, that's what I am doing, you also do this. That's what is the message of Buddha. If I want to help others, this is the best way to help others. Be an inspiration to others to become Buddhas by you becoming Buddha. That is the best service you can give to this world. You need not come back again and again and do this, do that, compassionately. No. This very bondage, this cycle of births and rebirths is a bondage. There's no need. Just I work to become Buddha by liberating my mind. In this process, I inspire other people to become Buddhas, become Arahants. That's it. That's what is the Buddhist core philosophy. Unlike this in other religions, one person is there. He only should come and save the people. He is only the savior. Other people are animals, are mindless people. But Buddha says, you have as beautiful minds as I have. If I can liberate my mind, why can't you liberate your mind? That's what is the beauty that attracted me towards Buddha's teachings. Okay, good. Okay, we'll conclude because it's time. We have to go for this Punyanamodana also. Or any other question? Last question.
Vandami Bhanteji?
Yes, Amma Upasika, Tejasvini, Gosabi.
Yes, Bhanteji, the process means way of liberation is same in other religions also? Like Jainism, Hinduism?
Yeah, if you see this cosmology, so have you completed level 3 also, Dr. Tejasvini Gosabi?
Yes, Bhanteji.
There I could introduce a little bit of Buddhist cosmology. In Buddhist cosmology, there are different planes of existence. See, for these Christians, for them, the divine beings, the heavens, that itself is liberation for them. They think they have reached liberation by reaching heavens. There always happiness is there. A lot of sensual happiness is there. And in Hinduism, in some Hindu sects, Hinduism is little tricky. So we can't generalize Hinduism. In some sects of Hinduism, for them, Brahma is the ultimate. So once you become, once you reach the Brahmic worlds, so that for them it is liberation. But if you see the Buddhist cosmology, there are 16 Brahma realms. There are 4 Arupa Brahma realms also. And if you transcend even those 4 Arupa Brahma realms, then you will get what is called Nibbana. For us, for the followers of Buddha, that transcending all these 31 planes and reaching Nibbana is liberation. But for these Christians, let us say, for example, because reaching this heavens itself is after human realm, there are some 6 divine beings. Of course, they explain the heavens in their own way, not the way it is explained like this here, the 6 realms, something like that. So reaching heavens itself is liberation. And some sects of Hinduism, reaching the Brahmic worlds is, liberation. And for the Shaivites, the quality of Shiva is almost like Arupa. There are some Arupa forms also. Arupa also, some sects explain in Hinduism. So if you reach some Arupa Brahma realms, that is Nibbana, that is liberation for some sects in Hinduism. For Islam, for Muslims, again, Allah is like formless and all. It's like, again, Arupa Brahma realms itself is liberation for Muslims. Again, of course, Buddha talks about 4 levels of Arupa Brahma. And one should transcend not just one first Arupa Brahma level. The other 3 Arupa Brahma levels also one should transcend. And then he will get Nibbana. That is what is ultimate liberation for the followers of Buddha. Once you reach that ultimate liberation state, that is Nibbana, then for him, there is no falling back. In all these other planes, whether it is Brahma realms, whether what the Brahma Hindus, they consider it as liberation, or for the Arupa Brahmas, for some Hindu sects and some Islamic sects, they consider as liberation. It's all reversible. One may fall back. It is not actually authoritative liberation. And from divine levels also, one will fall back. That is also not an authoritative liberation, because there is a possibility of falling back. Once your punya is over, once your purity is over, because you have not completely destroyed the defilements in the mind. So if there is some small defilement, it will start sprouting and it will become a bigger defilement and you will fall down to lower realms. That is what is the risk in the other wrong views, in other wrong perceptions about liberation. They think that reaching divine beings, there is a lot of bliss, lot of happiness, lot of sensual pleasures. But once you start enjoying the sensual pleasures, you will start developing ego, start developing craving, start developing attachment. That will become bigger and bigger, the defilements, and you will fall down into human realm, or you may become animal also. That's what happened once during Buddha's time also. When Brahma was having a lot of mental purity, he developed some defilement of ego, some defilement of ignorance, and he became a pig. Even a Brahma became a pig after some time, after his death. Though he was considering himself as he is the creator of this whole existence, he is completely liberated, and he is the person who is liberating others. In that way, he was thinking, but he himself became a pig after his punya was over, after his merits are over. That's what is the risk that Buddha talks about. That's what he gives this complete canvas, the entire picture of purifying the mind, completely purifying the mind and reaching the ultimate liberation. That's why this Buddha's the concept of Nibbana is very, very authoritative.
Yes, Bhante. Thank you, Bhante.
Okay, sadhu, sukhi hontu.
Vandana.
Okay, now we'll this small punyanamodana we'll do. Those who have made contribution, you can remember the departed relatives, you can remember their name. If you remember their face, you can remember them. Or if you can't remember their face, you can just remember some light. and then you just repeat this chanting. So that is what is Punyanumodana. Symbolically, one should pour some water, but now it is not possible. This is not a physical gathering. So now in the mind only, you just remember them and share these merits to your departed relatives. And also after that, of course, in the chanting also it is there. To all beings, we are sharing this because we are not being attached to this Punya also. This Punya also we are giving. Punya, how we accrued the Punya, how we accumulated the Punya by Dana, by giving Dana, by practicing Shila, by practicing meditation, by listening to Dhamma, by discussing Dhamma, then by knowing the right view, by establishing in the right view, by showing respect and gratitude, that is apachayana, by doing service, that is vayavacha. Many of you are doing service. So many things are the punya. But specifically, first you share your punya to your departed relatives, those who offered dana. For them, this chanting, actually in this chanting, so for those who have given dana, that is being highlighted in all this Punyanumodana chanting. And of course, other punyas also can be covered. So all other punyas are punyas only. Your Shila, your Vayavacha, your Seva, your Apachayana, your gratitude and respect. That's what is the highlight of this program today. Gratitude and respect. And then discussing Dhamma, listening to Dhamma, and straightening our view, coming out of the wrong views and establishing in right view, that is called Ditti Jukama. That is also meritorious action. That also we learned by learning this Brahmajala Sutta. So many meritorious actions we have practiced today. So now we share this meritorious action. Again, that will also become a merit. Punyanumodana or Pattidana. Pattidana. And we should rejoice in this. If somebody is sharing the merits, we should rejoice in this. That is called Pattanumodana. That rejoicing is also a punya. We should not be jealous. He is getting punya, so I am not getting punya. He is sharing punya. She is getting more punya. We should not become jealous of others' punya or others' patidana, their sharing of merits. We should rejoice in their merits. Then it becomes one more punya. It's called Pattanumodana. That way, almost all 10 merits we have practiced today. And we share this to our departed relatives first, and then to the all beings, including the devas, including the Brahma, all beings, even the animals. So we are sharing this to all beings after sharing to our departed relatives. You just repeat after me. Of course, not we can loudly also you can say, but you just mute your audios. Don't unmute so that it will become a disturbance. You just mute and you just repeat after me. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Those who offered chivara in their mind, so I want to offer chivara to Bhante and other requisites like vihara. Some people offered dana for the vihara, for the accommodation and for the different requirements of the vihara. In that sense, also some people offered. So those are called requisites. Amisadana. So those amisadana, they can remember for what sake they have offered, and then they can repeat this after me. Mayang bante samsaro kantaro sabba dukkato mochanattaya nibbanam sachikaranattaya kammancha kamma vipakancha saddahitva tisaranena saddhin panchashilani samadhi itva mama paraloka gata nyatino. Nyati means relative. Now you remember that relative, whether it may be Pituno, it may be your father, Matuno, it may be your mother, or maybe other relatives, you just remember them. Samuha sacha, mama kalyana mittancha, imani, sangadanani, attaparikaram danani. So what for you have given? Attaparikaram is like the minimum 8 requirements of that we really need. For that you have offered pindapatang danani for your food, jnanavattu danani, other vattu means other requirements, like medicine, like say maybe the different requirements in the accommodation in the monastery or in the meditation center. Ayasmanto dakkinodakam sanchitva danang dhinnang tang yathasukam paribunjantu. So wholeheartedly you are offering it and you are requesting just to accept and use them. Idam no jnatinam hotu sukita hontu jnatayo. From this offering, may my relatives also get the punya. Let this punya be shared by them also. Idam mo jnatinam hotu sukita hontu jnatayo. Idam no jnatinam hotu sukita hontu jnatayo. Unname udakam uttam yatha nindam pavattati evameva ito dindam petanang upakappatu yathavari vaha pura paripurenti sagara evameva ito dindam petanang upakappatu akasata cha bummatta devanaga mahiddika punyantam anumoditva chirang rakkantu sasanam akasata cha bummatta devanaga mahiddika punyantam anumoditva chirang rakkantu desanam ఆకాశతా చ బుమ్మట్ట దేవనాగా మహిద్దిక పుణ్యంతం అనుమోదిత్వా చిరంగ్రక్కంతు మం పరం యథావతా చ అమ్మేహి సంబతం పుణ్య సంపదం సబ్బే దేవా అనుమోదంతు సబ్బే భూత అనుమోదంతు సబ్బే సత్తా అనుమోదంతు సబ్బ సంపత్తి సిద్ధియా నిబ్బాన సంపత్తి సిద్ధియా ఇదం నే జ్ఞాతినం హోతు సుక్తా హోంతు జ్ఞాతయో సబ్బే బుద్ధా బలపాత పచ్చేకానంచ యంగ్బలం అర్హంతానంచ తేజేనా రక్కం వందామి సబ్బసో సబ్బే దమ్మా బలపాత అడియ సచ్చనంచ యంగ్బలం దమ్మ చక్కస్స తేజేనా రక్కం వందామి సబ్బసో సబ్బే సంగా బలపాత విముక్తానంచ యంగ్బలం శాసనస్స తేజేనా రక్కం వందామి సబ్బసో ఇమినా పుణ్యాకం ఏనా మామే బాల సమాగమో సతం సమాగమో హోతు యావ నిబ్బాన పత్యా ఇదం మే పుణ్యాకమ్మం ఆసవ కయం వహం హోతు సబ్బ దుఃఖా పముచ్చతు నిబ్బాన సంపచ్చయో హోతు సాధు 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 సుఖవంతు మంగళం. Okay, so that is conclusion.
Vandami Vanteji.
Vandami Vanteji. Thank you, Vanteji.
Vandami Vanteji.
Thank you so much, Vanteji.
Vandami Vanteji. Thank you,
Vanteji.
Vandami
Vanteji.
Thank you very much, Guruji.
Vandami Vanteji.
Vishnu is here, Vishnu is not there. Okay. Sadhu, sadhu. Kuki hantu, mangal ho.
Lala?